So it was awesome sitting down with James Woods and getting to ask him some stuff. He's got a big show on at the moment in America called Shark. But it was just cool to ask some questions, and we'll pick things up where we left off in part four.
Everybody says it's just gorgeous there, and the people are great. I mean, I'm not just saying this because you're from Australia. Yeah, everybody
cool.
says, you know,
I'm sure
they say that women are the most beautiful women on earth, so that's always a good thing. You know, what's not to like?
Now, we've been asking people across New York, from you know anybody, the person in the park, the top businessman there, if they could change the world, what would they do? So I'd like to ask you that. If you had the power to change the world, what would you do?
Oh, boy. Oh boy, I think.
Well, that's a tough question,
I tell you. I mean, I think more than anything else, I would want to make sure that so much of this food that we have that is sort of regulated, you know, I don't know if you know, but in this country and I think in other countries, a lot of grain is held in reserve to keep the grain prices up and so on. So there's a lot of food that is never sort of given to people or distributed whichever way throughout the world, and I just think that I'd like to see more food and medicine somehow get to people who need it. I don't know how you accomplish that, and I'm not sure, you know, I know many great people have tried, you know, who care about, you know, those who suffer, but I just think there is so much more suffering in the world than we, especially in our civilized countries, realize. When I say civilized, our economically, you know, advantaged countries realize, but I mean, I just think it would be so easy. I mean, I remember during the Kuwait War that when Saddam Hussein was, you know, was bombing all the Kurds, and they said that so many thousands of people died there, the refugees died from dysentery. I mean, literally a bottle of Pepto-Bismol could have saved a life, you know. I mean, you know, if they, you know, it costs a buck or something, and somehow they could never get that stuff through. And you just think about, you know, how easy it would be to save, you know, the millions of people who will be dying in Africa from, you know, AIDS, for example. And, you know, the medicines, if you did generic versions of them, would probably be very inexpensive, you know, to, you know, and so on. And it's just sad that food and medicine isn't gotten to people who really need it.
Yeah,
so I would like to find some way to do that, to make, get food and medicine available to people who need it, I guess.
That's cool.
You know?
Well,
I don't know how likely it would be that can ever happen with, you know, politics and economics the way they are, but I mean, it's funny when you ask that question, it's like a huge question.
Would
you want to get rid of the internal combustion engine so that people could, you know, the quality of life would be completely different, but, you know, that would just change quality of life. You'd actually save life with you know, all these, with these other ventures.
Yeah, I guess September 11th for you would have been very difficult as well. I mean, for every American, every person to do it.
I think so. I think really everybody, because you start to realize that there are people who, if they happen to, I don't even think it's, forget the people, they're always going to be vicious people with an agenda of their own. You know, you can say they're crazy, but they're not. They have an agenda for power that they want and so on. I mean, we had anarchists in the 1800s, you know. We've had anarchists forever. What makes it particularly threatening now is that anybody who has an agenda and is really ruthless and unafraid to carry out that agenda can now, with the present technology, really end the world. I mean, you know, I mean, if someone does release, you know, smallpox in a significant way throughout, you know, two or three continents, you know,
you could literally,
you know, take out half the population of the world.
Yeah.
You know, or nuclear weapons that promoted a nuclear interchange that would really make the world, you know, uninhabitable, which is highly likely. I majored in political science, and I mean, just the fallout of a significant nuclear exchange could be devastating. So, you know, the problem now is that the stakes are so much higher and so much more violent and vicious than they've ever been. You know, it's the difference between sort of people shooting at each other and people sort of taking out entire continents or countries, which is, you know, highly likely.
Well, let me say on behalf of Australia and for us two guys, thank you very much for your time.
My pleasure.
Thank you for being
you guys.
Thank you for being the kind of guy that would give your time to two young punks just asking you, interrupting your iced tea.
No, that's all right. See, I could be an official Australian. Everybody's always so, I hear they're always so pleasant. Well, all my American friends have gone over and say, God, the people are so nice that they welcome you and make you feel, you know, so, you know, we should return the favor.
Well, thank you very much.
Okay, thanks.
Hey,
how you doing?
Thanks, Woods.
You
know, I need a release.
I actually just gave my last thing to this guy. I'm really sorry. Thank you.
James, just before we go, I mean, this is amateur hour, but would I be able to get a release from you just to say it's James Woods and it's okay for us to use the interview for
This is James Woods and you guys can use this, but, you know, don't use it like in a porn or something.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, so we were pretty pumped after that experience and getting back to filming the sights, the Saddle Ranch there on the Sunset Strip and the Hyatt Hotel. And the very famous Comedy Store. If you ever get a chance to go to LA, you want to hang out in this part of town at night. It's awesome. A lot of people playing there at the Comedy Store. And as I did my best little getaway impersonation talking about the House of Blues, we set up the plans for the night ahead.
About that. Tonight we're about to go back and hang out with Vinny. He's making us dinner. And then we're going to go check out the Oscar De La Hoya, Fernando Vargas fight, which is a big deal here in LA. And then who knows what's going to happen after that. So tomorrow there'll be more fun on the streets of LA. So we're at Dublin's on Sunset. It's 10 past 8.
Almost fight time.
We're here with Vinny. We're about to watch Fernando Vargas and Oscar De La Hoya. Big crowd. We paid our 10 bucks to get in. We got our, what is this, Irish beer?
This is Newcastle Brown Ale.
Beautiful. And who are you tipping? Who's your tip?
My tip? De La Hoya, 11th round.
It'd be good to see that too. So,
yeah, and you wouldn't believe it, after watching one of the fights of the year, it was awesome. De La Hoya won by knockout in the 11th round, so it was just crazy, and we headed back to Vinny's place. So Vinny could give one of his friends the update of the night.
Well, he got kicked too. His nose was bleeding, De La Hoya and shit, you know. For the first six rounds, it was even. They would take a round apiece, and the kid is much stronger than fucking Oscar, much stronger. Yeah, he did. But it looked like, when was it, the 10th round? He came out, De La Hoya, no, the 9th.
Yeah, no.
After taking two rounds, a two-round lead, he went into that thing with, like, Trinidad again, running away, covering up. And we were saying, what the fuck happened? He just looked so good the last round. But then the fucking 10th, he went back again, ba-boom. And then the 11th, he came out. He really went to work on. It was exciting, though, you know, because they both landed good blows. They both bleeding. From the eye, what's his name, is bleeding under his eye, top of his head. What's his name, his nose is fucking bleeding, getting in his mouth and stuff. Well, it was a good, exciting fight. Fucking crowd was nuts. This fucking place up here is fucking packed. Yeah, Dublin, forget about it. $10 a head. I wonder how much they have to pay, like the bar, to carry the fight. I mean, they don't get it for $55 and then let all those people in, that's for sure. I think, no, they got to pay something. It's like depending on the capacity or whatever. Anyway, it was exciting. Andrew had a good time. We filmed in there. And he's going, here we are at the thing. We're going to watch the fight. And Vin, what do you think? I said, ah, De La Hoya with the 11th. I don't know what the fuck is. And it turned out that way.
Yeah, so that was it. I hope Vinny doesn't mind me putting that on there. But an amazing end to just an incredible day. And showing what's possible with the web show. That's the way I feel about the show every day, really, because the same sort of stuff happens. It might not be James Woods and stuff, but it's still cool. So thanks for checking out all the clips, and I really appreciate your support.
You're working your way from the ground down.